Hello, can you
Yo,
hear me?
I can hear you. We
Okay.
doing audio, or we should probably just do audio, huh?
Yeah, I've got audio. So
Okay.
all right, sweet. So I'm gonna be like 20 seconds behind whatever I'm seeing on your screen.
Oh yeah, but you can hear
You
me.
could, yeah, you could screen share. You could screen share on Skype, and
I
that
want.
way I can.
Do you think that'll totally kill the live
Oh,
stream?
it might if you run the game, it might make it a little laggy.
I don't care about my processor. I care about the stream quality.
Yeah. All right. Don't worry about it. I'll just be a little behind to whatever you're doing.
I'm not
Is
that
my
fast anyway.
mic volume okay? Because I'm using a condenser mic and I don't know how
Oh,
well it.
it sounds great to me. I'm gonna turn down the music on my
Yeah.
end.
Okay. Sweet.
Cool. You
Woohoo.
guys just let me know if you can hear Lisa okay.
Yay! I'm on the show.
Welcome to the show, every Lisa. You're aggroing all of our sweet viewers.
Yay.
This is
Apparently, someone's hyped for Wordle Insight. All right, now I gotta get some
hyped.
insights.
What do you guys want to know from Lisa? I've got two
Yeah.
screens set up going on. I got my iPad so I can watch the chat while I work, which is
It's
pretty.
nice. Look at that.
Guys, Lisa's here.
It's true. Here.
Lisa, what did? How long have you been with Insomniac?
5 years, a little over 5 years actually.
That's
Over
like.
5 years in June, maybe 5 and a half. Oh my gosh, it's almost 5 and a half years.
Whoa.
Woo.
Do you get like a
And if you
coin? Or like a.
What actually on our 5 year anniversary, they give us an extra week vacation and a travel voucher. So they're
Whoa.
like, happy 5 years, get the hell out. Take a vacation.
Chill out.
So Nick and I are gonna go to Korea in the spring. We're gonna use our own
Oh my
vouchers.
god. You going to Seoul?
Yeah.
Or like you going all over?
Yep. We're probably gonna go to Seoul. We're really just wanting to go there for the StarCraft, which I know is kind of nerdy. But whatevs, that's the plan.
Is
So
there
we'll
like
probably go.
a special time to go?
Well, we gotta see when the GSL schedule is so we can catch a tournament. But we'll figure it out figure it all out.
Figure it out.
Teddy, someone made a Let's Play of my 7-day FPS game, and
No
they
way.
were like laughing and having fun, and it made me so happy.
Oh, that's awesome. That's the best thingy. That's the thing we
There's.
don't get with a lot of big games. It's like that feedback loop where it's like more frequent
Yeah.
feedback for, or like positive reinforcement for all the hard work.
Yeah, actually, on Sunset, because people were streaming it, like. It made it a lot better because when we released it, we were able to like jump into streams and see people having a good time. And I was like, yeah, people are having fun with the game. Woo!
Yeah,
So
that
it,
was my favorite part of the releasing the Hyperlight preview was like people were streaming
yeah.
it that night. And I was like, oh man, I can watch them. Also, I got to look at my analytics that you helped me set up. And
Yeah!
really
I
the
see the
most,
data, man.
yeah, pretty much the most important piece of data is that nobody has done as many chain dashes in a row as I have. Still, boom. I'm still the best Hyperlight Drifter player.
Boom. Someone asked how slowdown bull going is going, and it's going good. We're just in that weird phase. We're like figuring out like launch details and stuff, and things that I can't really take part in because it's like money things and whatnot. So it's sort of like, yeah, we're just like figuring out all these like squirmy little details, and I'm also trying to fix like the worst bug. So Nick told me that at the end of every project, no matter what the project is, it'll be the very end, you'll be out of time, and you'll get the bug. And the bug is like the most painful, hard to repro bug, but it's like really bad. It's like, we'll ruin everything. You have to fix it. And the only way you can repro it is like playing through the entire game. And it's like really obscure. And he says, you'll get that bug and it'll be terrible and you just gotta fix it. And I've got that bug right now and
Oh
it's
God,
awful. It's awful.
in Sunset or in 7 Day?
No, in Slowdown Bull.
Oh, in 7 Day. Hey, will
Yeah.
you tell our friends what repo is?
Repro is reproduce. So like when QA finds a bug, they're like, here's what happened. Here are the steps you take to get this bug so you know how to test it so you can make it happen and fix it. But sometimes things don't don't have very clear repro steps. It just like maybe shows up like 10% of the time. And part of being a good QA tester is figuring that out. It's kind of like, so here's the thing, like QA is really super undervalued as just like its own skill set. People often think of QA as, oh, you get into QA so you can work up and become something else. But the skills of a good QA tester are actually like very specific. It's kind of like being a scientist, because you gotta make your hypothesis about what might be causing the bug and isolate the variables and reproduce the results, and you know, it's like science, and you gotta
it's
do
just
that.
Like science.
It is like science. It's like the scientific method. It really is. And so part of the job of a QA tester is to figure out repro steps so that when they give the bug to the developer, they can are able to make it happen so that they can fix it. But sometimes it's not easy.
What's the like someone asked how many chain dashes I've done. I think my record is 320. what was I gonna ask you? Oh, so Slowdown Bowl, like that's like a project that they let you do at Naughty Dog that's like a whole
Insomniac.
New game, right?
Oh, you did the faux pas, you confused Insomniac and Naughty Dog.
What did I say?
You said Naughty Dog.
What?
You totally said Naughty Dog.
Oh no.
I forgive you.
Holy
it's
crap.
Fine. It's fine.
Oh, but you guys don't like each other. You're both.
No, we do. It's just funny because people always mix us up, and they all like it's really awkward. Someone tells us how much they love Jack and Daxter.
Oh well, I don't
like,
do that
oh,
shit.
Where it is, that's the wrong. But anyway, Slowdown Bowl. It was an experiment where they wanted to try having someone work on prototypes and come up with a small game idea for a small team. Mm-hmm. And they're like, Lisa, you want to do this? And I was like, yeah. So I made a prototype and came up with a game and just took it through the whole process and dev streamed all summer, and that went really well. And we're gonna do more dev streams, guys, because everyone was like, oh no, we're sad because you're done with dev streams. I'm like, don't worry, I'm gonna make it happen in the future, but maybe not till the new year because I'm traveling a bunch. Anyway. Yeah, Insomniac was just like, we're going to try this out and see how it goes.
Oh, man.
And, yeah, it was great.
So is that the sort of thing where, like, how much of your time were you spending on that versus Sunset?
All of it. I was full time.
That's what I thought.
Yeah, like a year and some months ago, I moved off Sunset and went full time onto this little project.
Is there a comma in the name?
There is a comma. Okay. Which I'm like kind of like wondering if that was a mistake, because having your title, you know, you have to do all sorts of nonsense where you have to put in the title. I'm like, what if
about I, hashtags?
Yeah, people don't like the
how
commas, right?
It? Uh-huh.
So it's kind of like.
Oh no, what's wrong? Oh no, I'm stuck.
Anyway, yeah, so that was awesome. So yeah.
That's super cool. So you're on break right now, kind of like.
Well, I'm in sort of a weird transition period because I'm still like helping out with like Slowdown Bowl stuff, like getting gameplay footage for the marketing guys that they want to make a trailer and all that. But I'm also working with our small team that did like Outernauts and doing prototypes for them. So basically, between now and the end of the year, I'm just making a ton of prototypes. And it's actually pretty great. Which granted, between now and the end of the year, actually I don't have that much time because Insomniac gives everyone 2 weeks off for the holidays and Thanksgiving's in there and I'm traveling a ton. So I really don't have that much time left between now and the end of the year. So they're like, they're just like, Lisa, you're really good at fast prototypes. So we want you to work on a ton of prototypes. I'm like, okay, I'm down for that. It's super fun.
I can do what I'm good at.
Yeah.
Teddy,
I want to ask you a question.
Hit me.
This isn't the Lisa Brown show. This is the Lisa and Teddy show. All right. What is the most challenging thing about making this game?
The most challenging thing. Well, the one most challenging thing. It's been. There's, like, I guess the most challenging design thing, and then there's the most challenging.
This is the Lisa and Teddy show.
production.
Sorry, Nick is 20 seconds behind and he's cracking up at the Lisa and Teddy show.
Oh, he's watching
this. Fine. It's the Teddy and Lisa show. Fine. He's making fun of me because I headlined the show.
Oh.
Hard headlined the show. Anyway.
Amazing.
Most challenging thing.
Well, our fine host, Lisa. So one of the things that's been like the impetus for this project is really indulgent and unspecific in terms of like what the game has to be. Like the whole point of me starting this was like originally I was like, hey, I want to make 4-player Bushido Blade, and that was my goal. And so I started by doing that, and I learned a lot of things about what it could and couldn't be, and like eventually I discovered that it couldn't be Bushido Blade because what was more important to me is that it was 4-player and isometric, and Bushido Blade like isn't playable with an isometric camera because you can't see the sword angles properly like you can in like a lower camera. So it's just been this process of the game, all of the design stemming from like, I just want this to be a game that represents my favorite things. And so combining those things and seeing what kind of game they make is like a really weird process, but kind of fun. And now I'm like trying out this whole new gameplay flow, which is kind of quasi-experimental, so I think it's pretty doable, but that's been one of the hard things. The other thing has just been that I've discovered that it's a valuable side project to me outside of Kyoto, outside of Hyperlight, because it's like a different type of game, and it makes me feel refreshed, and it makes me like, it lets me do other things, like art and level design. This is something I spend all my time on Hyperlight, but also like, I've discovered I don't want to do that much programming because I program like most of the day on Hyperlight. So I think I'm bringing someone else onto the team, which is pretty exciting. I just have some businessy things to work out, but it's been a challenge.
It's challenging to be like, oh crap, I have to program more. I just want to do this art and level design. Oh my God, that sort of thing.
Yeah, it's just challenging to like sit down and then think about like, oh man, like I have to start on this whole new brand new thing and like program it and stuff. Maybe that's hard on every game, but hey, I can move back and forth between these two rooms. That worked.
Yeah. Nick did sort of something like that in that he has his side project that he's working on. So he programs all day at Insomniac and then comes home and programs all night on Uniball.
Whoa.
And just like a boss.
It's yeah. Cool. I've decided that like for this project, I need to do other things. So for this, I'm going to focus on art and arena design and art mostly, and like producing and like actually running the team.
Cool. Sweet.
What's the hardest?
Someone. No, wait, go ahead.
Someone. Is the chat asking anything?
Yeah, someone asked what it's like working at Insomniac.
Oh, you should answer that question.
It's super cool. I really like it there. I've been there 5 years, and I've been on 3 projects, and they've all been different, and I like them all. And I don't know. It's cool. It's a really, like, the thing I like the most about Insomniac is there's this, like, philosophy of the place to constantly figure out how to get better, like, in every way.
Mm.
And I think we do, and there's always new challenges, but it's just very, very apparent that they're always wanting to get better as a studio, and that makes it really nice to work in that environment. So that's my favorite thing. That's good. What were you going to ask me?
I was going to ask you what the hardest thing about your job is.
My job, or about which?
About Slow Down Bowl, because like...
About Slow Down Bowl, okay.
Moving from big games to something that's more like,
yeah,
smaller,
teeny tiny. I guess the most challenging thing about how can I answer that? Because I know the most, I have ideas like what was the most challenging thing about like the working on the game itself, but as far as the process and transitioning from big project to small project, I think the most challenging thing was trying to be nimble like a small team and still work within the context of a bigger company. because there's stuff that I was unable to do that like a little indie team could do without any hesitation, just because, you know, it's still part of Insomniac, so it still has to fit in with all of their like scheduling and like as far as like the dev streams, right? Mm-hmm. Like they're like, we need a community person in the dev stream every week because we want to be there if any bombs drop. So so if no community people were available, then we couldn't stream. And I was like, oh, but I want to stream. But like, we, you know, we couldn't.
Does that mean like community managers who have marketing training and stuff? So that like,
yeah, like so our we have like a team that's like combination community marketing and brand management. They're people that wrangle the forums and all the social media, but they're also the people that make our, like, you know, video preview stuff for Sunset and, like, just handle all of that. So it's all one big team, or it's one small team. I don't know. I guess it's biggish. But, you know, they wanted people there just in case anything went amiss. So, like, if I was just, like, on my own, then be like, whatever, I'm just streaming because I'm just going to do it. Or, like, since it's still part of a company, it's being like, all right, what do we think about this? And Ryan's like, well, or like posting the dev logs. Because it'd be like, if it was just me, I would just post them whenever.
Yeah.
But working on a big team, it's like, oh, we have to schedule when we release this because we have Sunset TV going up on this day. And then we have like an Outer Knots announcement going up on this day. So let's have it go this day at this time. And it's like, oh, but I want to post it right now. Because it's still like part of the big company narrative, so you have to like work within that.
Yeah.
Which I thought it was something that I wasn't anticipating, and it's been, I think that's probably been the most challenging, is like figuring out how to work within all that.
Do you? Here's a question. Mm. I'm really curious. I mean, I've spent some time at bigger studios. I worked at Disney for a couple of years, and I worked at Microsoft for a brief time. But like, do you feel insulated as a designer at all, like in terms of what you're allowed to talk about as far as like your work and what you've learned or the problems you're trying to deal with? And by insulated,
oh,
I mean,
you mean
that,
like
you only get to share certain information with people at Insomniac.
I think it varies. Like, well, with Slow Down Bowl, it was like we're being super open with this, and they're like, all right, we're being super open. So that's like different. But with Sunset or things like that, it's kind of in the middle, because on the one hand, there's still like NDA stuff that, you know, we can't talk about. But on the other hand, Insomniac's really encouraging of all of its employees to like submit GDC talks and, you know, get information out there. And some companies aren't like that. Like some companies are very like very cagey about having their employees speak at stuff, you know?
Yeah.
So it's kind of in the middle, but I think that I feel pretty free talking about like just general design challenges and things learned, as long as it's not attached to any specific like IP related NDA stuff. Like I don't feel like, oh, I can't talk about this and I really wish I could. Like if there's like design challenges, I can usually abstract them to where I'm not like worried about like telling all the secrets or whatever.
I always worry more about like whether that has effect on someone over the long term. Like, I don't know. I feel like there's so many things I'm able to do that, I don't know. It's very weird. It comes with pluses and minuses to be able to talk about a project in any way you want, whenever you want. Largely, you have to do all the things we're talking about that Insomniac does.
Yeah.
Like, PR training and syncing up the larger narrative of the company, like some of that stuff can be restrictive, but also like when you go to do that for yourself, you're like, oh man, I have to have a narrative. Like I have to help people understand what's happening with this game and like when it's coming out and like all these things.
Yeah, I think that it's been very refreshing with Slow Down Bowl because that was the whole thing. Like, hey, we're going to be open about this and I'm going to talk about whatever. And everyone was like, all right, let's do it. And Ryan at first was super nervous. He was like, I'm nervous, but I believe in this, so we're going to do it. Bah. So that's been nice. And a lot of times it's not like the company. A lot of times it's like, oh, you know, we can't, it's like the publisher, like Microsoft's like super secretive, right? Mm. They're like crazy secure.
Well, they're a software company, so they have this heritage of like locked doors. I remember when I worked at Microsoft, like there were like doors we weren't allowed to go in because there's a project being, they're like, people had special key card access to certain rooms. Yeah. So it's like, man.
When we first got the Durango dev kits, like when we very first got them, there was a limited number of them. And you had to keep them like locked in a cabinet when you weren't at your desk. Like they came in like a literal like cabinet with a key.
What?
And if you weren't using it and you were at your desk, you had to like lock it in the cabinet.
Was Durango the code name for X-Bone?
Yeah, that was the X-Bone dev kit. And that was like, oh my gosh, because it's like, how do you get any work done? But you know, it's just like the philosophy of the company. When you're a great big company like that, and you're like, oh, when you have like a brand that you have to worry about that's encompassing that many people, it's like a lot crazier. But I've never felt like really restricted, I suppose. I feel like there's a lot of information that we can like share with each other that I don't feel like I'm like, oh no, I can't talk about this and I really want to or anything like that.
I feel like I had a thought. I'm also typing a tweet, so that's distracting if I'm being honest.
Nick says there was a one door at Insomniac that we couldn't go in that had the Blu-ray burner in it.
Why? Because Blu-ray technology, this is prototype Blu-ray technology.
I don't know. Why couldn't you go in that room?
I think they just didn't want people like burning PlayStation 3 games.
They just didn't want people going in and burning PlayStation 3 games.
It's gonna happen anyway.
Oh, well.
I was gonna say, I think it can be hard for younger designers or people who, like, particularly when it comes to job searching and stuff. Like, I remember when I left Disney and I was, like, poking around the internet one night. I was like, oh, Moby Games. Like, am I a Moby Games? And I am. And I was like, oh, cool. And I was like, what games am I credited on? And, like, I wasn't credited at Disney, of course. I guess. Well, not of course.
They don't credit anyone, do they?
They don't. I emailed my old producer. I didn't know. What's up? Andrew's on the stream.
Hi, Andrew.
Hey, Katie. I was at, I emailed my producer and I was like, hey, I was wondering if, like, I can't find on the website. I was working on Pirates of the Caribbean Online, which is kind of a fun MMO. And I was like, hey, where are the credits? So I was like, I can't find them on the site and I can't find them in the game. Like, where do we put them? And he was like, oh, we don't credit developers because, and I think the excuse was because we're worried that fans would try to contact them.
Yeah, like, I remember because I was, I interned at Shell Games and like worked on the Pixie Hollow MMO when I was in graduate school. And they're talking about like Disney doesn't credit their contractors, and Shell Games did a lot for them. They did the Midway Mania ride at Disneyland and
they did a lot
there's no credit, right?
Yeah, they had mini games in Pirates of the Caribbean.
Yeah, Disney just doesn't credit them. And so that's like really sucky. So Insomniac does the thing where we just list the entire company in the credits of every single game.
Right.
So like, I have the opposite problem in that I'm on Moby Games, but I'm like listed for games I didn't actually work on, right? I'm in all the Ratchet games because I'm in the credits, but I didn't work on those games. So it's like the opposite problem. Like, it's kind of weird, I suppose.
Wait, you didn't work on them, but you're in the credits. Yeah, it's...
Yeah.
I mean, you know.
So if you go to look at me on Moby Games, I have like a billion shipped titles on there, but I've only ever shipped Resistance 3 and Sunset Overdrive.
Yeah.
And I guess maybe Resistance 2, I was an intern on that, and I think I'm in like the special thanks on that. But... since we have a policy of just listing the entire company in the credits of all of our games, it shows up on Moby Games as those being.
Yeah, I mean, that happens all over. I think I'm credited on Nidhogg for like getting a special thanks, but I didn't develop that game. It's like that doesn't count.
Yeah, I feel like Moby Games is not as big a deal now as it was like maybe like 3 or 4 years ago. But maybe that's just me. Like, I don't know if that's actually the case or if that's it's not as big a deal to me anymore, if it's not as big a deal in the context of the industry. I just feel like it doesn't, I don't hear people talk about it anymore, really.
Yeah, I agree with that. But I think having a database for credits is important at the end of the day. The other thing, wait, quick pause. Someone asked for you to explain a little bit about what you do on Sunset Overdrive. Like, I guess, what is your job title / what did you work on?
Yeah, so I was a designer on Sunset. I was on pre-production and production for about a year in. So on pre-production, there was about 20 of us, and we were just responsible for prototyping mechanics and, you know, proposing designs for bigger features and stuff. But it was mostly a lot of prototyping in that phase and just sort of figuring out the core mechanics. So it's weird. The designers sort of, the responsibilities like shift around all over early in pre-production and production.
Yeah.
So I was responsible for like a billion systems that all got cut because Drew was like, Lisa, you're really good at crazy stuff. We're going to have you try all these crazy things. I'm like, all right, I'm trying all the crazy things.
Okay.
All the crazy things get cut because they're crazy.
Yeah.
But other than those, I was, I did a lot with like the core combat, I suppose. Joel Goodsell, who's the senior combat designer on the project, told me. So you know how I did that level design talk at Glitch Demo Night that time with the, you know, the one?
Which
the
one?
The level design dragon talk, like the Lisa Brook, the level design apple thing.
Yeah.
So that what I was talking about specifically in that talk was an incident where it was early. I think it was like really late pre-production or really early in production, but it was after we had decided that traversal was in the game and that we were going to have shooting. We were going to have combat during traversal because super early on it was like, oh, we'll have traversal will be a thing, and then combat will be like more traditional run around the ground. But then we decided, oh no, we gotta combine. So really early on, they had all the designers mock up combat spaces to sort of figure out how to make that fun. Mm-hmm. And so I mocked up this big old, like, it was a food court, I think. And and it was Joel told me that space was a big inspiration for how combat ended up eventually, how they decided to go with it.
Oh, like, that's super cool.
It gave all the designers like a ton of ideas for how to integrate traversal in combat. So that's something I'm particularly proud of. But for a long time, I also did a lot on Chaos Squad. It was basically I don't know how I ended up getting in charge of that, because that's like not a thing I would like consider. Like, I was like, I guess I can design a multiplayer mode, sure. But it was like me and another designer, and they were like, it started out as, it used to be called Riot Squad, but we changed it to Chaos Squad. And they were just like, we don't know what it is. We just want a mode with like 6 to 8 people.
Uh-huh.
A cooperative mode with 6 to 8 people. And that was like it. And we had like some images of like what they wanted it to feel like.
Okay.
Like, all right, so we went through like just a billion iterations of what this mode might be, and it changed up with like tech and yeah. Just to clarify in the chat, so I'm not a level designer. We don't have like specifications like that in Insomniac. Like, everyone's just a designer, and everyone does a bit of level design, a bit of combat design, a bit of systems, whatever.
That's probably my fault. I might have said that at some point.
Yeah, some people have sort of specialties that they're really good at. Like, Liz was basically a system designer because she's really skilled at that. But we don't have like specific titles. But anyway, we spent like 6 months just like iterating on what this mode could be. And then it got handed off because I transitioned onto Slow Down Bull at that point. And then they like iterated it like a billion more times. So like what Chaos Squad is now, like it's so this is something weird about working on big games like this. Is I can see, like, I worked on Chaos Squad for 6 months, but I can't like point at it and be like, oh, I designed Chaos Squad, because
has it changed?
I didn't, but all of the work I did ended up like leading to it, right? Because there's still things in that mode that were things that were part of my prototypes. And when you work on a big AAA game like that, it's you kind of get skilled at detaching yourself from the game and like being like, all right, we're working on this thing and then I'm going to hand it off and you're going to work on it. And like everyone touches it and it becomes its own thing. Like it's the game. Mm. You're just sort of like taming it versus working on something smaller where like the whole thing is yours. Mm. I don't know if this makes any sense.
Yeah. Is that to say that like that can be harmful to motivation or something?
No, it's actually not bad. It's actually something I consider something that I really like about working in AAA because it feels like it just feels like something that everyone had a part in shaping. So it doesn't, it's like no one's, it's not no one person's idea. It's like the game started being born, then everyone's like taming it. Like it's its own beast. Mm. And you're just like figuring out what it is and where it wants to go. And everyone has a hand in sort of shaping it and pushing it in that way.
That's cool. So, you know, it's funny.
It's actually, go ahead.
I actually feel the same thing has happened with Hyperlight, even though it's just a very small team, because there's five of us full time right now, which is me and Bo. And so Bo and I do all the programming, and I would say we do all the game design, but it's become one of those things that everyone has a small hand in. But, you know, like in the traditional sense, we're probably the game designers, you know, we're the ones who've made games before, and that's our profession or whatever.
Yeah.
But even between Bo and I, like, we pass things back and forth so much that it's gotten to the point where, like, there are a few things that I own and a few things that he owns, but a lot of the stuff is just, like, our work, you know? Like, when people say, oh, the character feels really good, it's like, that's, like, 4,000 lines of code that is both of us, and so it's, like, a really healthy thing. I'd be like, yeah, that's our thing. Which I think also makes it easier to like, not have credit for other things, if you know what I mean? Because, like, when you work on small things, you get used to having, like, ownership of it. So when you work with another person, it's like, oh, wait, like, that's not my thing, or I didn't do that. Like, oh, like, someone will come up with packs and be like, oh, I love this part, and you have to be like, oh, that person did it.
Yeah.
But I think, like, having shared things makes it, and having your own things, I don't know. It's like a balance of feeling responsible for a game.
Yeah, I think that it can also relieve a lot of pressure. Like, I noticed just observing designers at Insomniac when we're trying to figure something out, and like it gets handed around among all of us, and everyone's working to solve the problem because they're working to figure out what the game wants to be, and there's not the pressure of this game is an extension of myself, and it's super personal, which puts a lot of, you know, there's a lot of pressure there. And when like the game feels like its own thing that's coming into existence, and you're just trying to figure out how to dig it out there, you know, and it's like the focus is out of you and onto the game, and there's not, it just becomes like a problem solving thing where like, okay, what is this game and how are we going to make it into itself? And it's less like I'm making a very personal game that's an extension of me.
Yeah.
And it's like a completely different feeling. And I think that, I don't know, maybe people don't get that if they don't look, because like a lot of people are like, oh, this is Lisa and she made Resistance 3, and I'm like, I didn't make it. I worked on it. But it's not like I, you know, that sounds weird versus like a, you know, a small project or whatever. It's like, yeah, this is really personal and this is an extension of me. And that's like a different challenge, I suppose. And it's actually something that I feel like I'm not skilled at because I don't have a lot of experience at in the whole, like, I'm making a game that's a personal expression of me. So I don't know. They're both skill sets, right?
I think that the way that I think about it, personally. Oh, hey, Scott's on the stream. Bombs
hi,
Fall.
Scott.
Who works on Night in the Woods?
True.
Hi, Scott. Anyway, yeah. The way that I view like making anything is that like, and particularly with the games I'm working on now, is that like, It's an extension of me, but it's not necessarily like, I'm not necessarily saying anything about myself. It's just, I think the word I usually use is an amplifying of, like, existence. That it's like, these are the things that I am and what I do and what I like, and I'm just gonna, like, amplify. I'm gonna, like, take it and put it in other things to assimilate them so that if people touch those things, they're, like, experiencing a bit of me. So it doesn't necessarily mean, like, oh, this game is about my struggles with sadness or whatever. I think all games have struggles about sadness. So it's not necessarily, like, subject-wise about me. Like, Kyoto Wild has very much nothing to do with me, but it's an expression of, like, things that I like, and I consider it to be, like, related to me in a way that means that I care about what people think about it. Yeah. So I would say, like, that thinking, I would imagine, though I haven't maybe taken this to a bigger team after I've developed this thought, would still apply. That, like, a level that you do or a system that you work on or something, I like, that when someone experiences that, like, it's not like, oh, this was a level that, like, Lisa worked on that's, like, it looks like her childhood home. Like, it's not biographical.
Funny story about that. So in Resistance 3, like, I did the boat level, which is, you're, like, you're on a boat and you're through this flooded town and stuff.
Uh-huh.
And a lot of that was referenced from my hometown, because I was like, oh, hey, you know, there was this big flood in the 30s in Louisville, and my friend has this scrapbook of all these newspaper clippings from it. I should borrow it from him and come and bring it for my team. And so I did, and I brought it to the environmentalist artists, and they freaked out. They were like, oh my God, this is the best thing ever. And it was, like, a huge source of inspiration for them. And there's this part in the level where you go under this bridge, and the Goliath comes and he steps on the bridge, and it's real dramatic. But when I was home visiting Louisville one time, I was told my artist, I was like, I'm going to get a bunch of reference pictures of what underneath a bridge looks like, because that's hard to find on the internet. So I went down to the river and, like, went under all the bridges and took all these pictures of, like, what the underside of a bridge looks like.
Wow.
Like a railroad bridge and stuff, and brought it back for my artist. And he was like, oh, this is amazing. This is the best thing ever. Oh, my God. So, yeah, that you could point at that level and be like, yeah, that's Lisa's childhood. But it's also not just mine, but, like, all of us. Like, my artist, he's from Kansas. Because the town was, like, in sort of, like, a Midwestern thing. It was supposed to be just outside of St. Louis.
Mm-hmm.
So, like, there was a lot, like, that whole little pod that worked on that level. There was a lot of us in there.
That's so funny.
Yeah. So Scott asked, do you feel like a level of distance allows you to focus on your actual work, if that makes sense? And I think it does. I think I know what you're talking about. One thing I have noticed in working in Insomniac is the designers that I've worked with are very much into mastering their craft as designers.
Hmm.
And I think that having a distance from the game, it makes it really easy to do that, because it's like a craft. I don't know exactly how to describe it in words that make sense. But, like, my friend Mike Burkhead, he's a designer, and he's like a systems designer.
Uh-huh.
And because you know how, like, indie developers are very much about, like, the community, right? And because there's, like, this whole supportive community, and people are, like, talking to each other all the time and exchanging, like, knowledge.
Uh-huh.
And then there are people like Mike who like, they, like, they're like the hermit on the mountain that just spends, like, 10 years mastering this craft, and he will, like, who plays tons of games, but he dissects them, and he, like, reverse engineers systems.
Mm-hmm.
In every game that he plays, and he just, like, that's how he's become such a good systems designer. But his focus isn't on, like, the game development community. He is mastering a craft, and that is, like, his focus. And it's great because you can, like, go up to the mountain and be like, hey, Mike Burkhead, will you help me with this thing? And he just has all this knowledge that I just, like, consume. But it's a sort of a different feeling of than I don't know. It's like, it's something I see a lot in AAA in general, is there are people who are just so passionate about their craft.
Mm.
And I know that, like, there's this stigma of, like, oh, there's, you know, people, there's, like, 10 people, and all they do is render grass and derp, derp, AAA. But you know what? Those people are really passionate about rendering grass, and they're probably really fucking good at it.
Yeah,
so
dude.
you can probably, you're going to have to render grass in your game someday. You could probably, like, go to these people and, like, learn something from them. But I think that, like, that stigma comes and people assume that that's, like, horrible work, like, horrible mind-numbing work. But there are seriously people that they just want to be the best at rendering grass, and they get really fucking excited about it, and they're really happy doing that.
Yeah, I think it's just kind of like, man, it's like a weird staffing and HR question. Because there are probably also people who, like, my friend Eric worked, our friend Eric worked on, like, the blood for Slaughterhouse.
Mm-hmm.
Like, his job was blood maker. Like, he was basically, like, the graphics designer, that's not a thing. graphics programmer for blood. Someone says my shirt looks like Ness's shirt. Thank you. I just started maining Ness in Smash Brothers Melee, and I'm getting real good at him.
Mm-hmm.
What was I saying? Yeah, and, like, he worked only on blood, and to hear him talk about it, it's like, after a while, like, for him, it's like, okay, like, I gotta make more blood. It's like, I think you just have to... Yeah, I think people... it's not so much a stigma, it's, like, a concern. Because for every person who fucking loves rendering grass, there's someone who doesn't love rendering grass, but must.
Right.
And you just have to kind of be careful.
That's true.
Neither is an appropriate blanket statement, is maybe the best way to put it.
So I found a link to all the pictures of the flood scrapbook. Does anyone want to see it? You want to see them?
Post it. I want to see them.
All right, I'll post it in the chat.
I'll stream them on the chat or whatever.
All right. Oh, okay. Well, here, I'll just post them to the Skype.
Oh yeah, secret link for me.
Secret link only for Teddy.
Except it's showing up there. Nobody read it.
It's not a secret. It's public on Facebook.
That was a secret. It's mine. Where is it? I'm gonna grab the link, copy, and then I'm gonna hide this window. So only I can show the world these photos, except people who have Facebook accounts. Resistance 3 boat level inspiration.
I don't know, this probably doesn't mean anything to anyone who hasn't played the game, but there's, like, this flooded town that you go through on a boat. And you, like, fight things.
Whoa. Oh, so these are, like, newspaper clippings?
These are newspaper clippings from, like, the 30s, where there was this big flood in Louisville, and it was, like, a big freaking deal. And my friend had this scrapbook with all these pictures. And, like, that second picture where it's, like, the bridge and the mist, there's, like, it's really foggy. You can see the bridge in the distance. Mm. And my environment artist, like, freaked out about that. And they were like, oh, my God, that's great. And if you play the game, like, that, it's basically that scene is in the game, because it made my artist super, super excited. But you, I brought this scrapbook home, I was like, here, everybody, and they just got really inspired by it. So it's like a way of getting your own, my own little, like, personal history, like, into a game. And then there's all these pictures of, like, just, like, little rooftops just surrounded by water because the flood is so bad. And there's a part in the level where you're going through, like, just rooftop islands, and the long legs are jumping from roof to roof, and you have to fight them and stuff. I don't know.
Cool.
Stuff
Let's
like that
photos.
Is exciting to me. I don't know if it's interesting to anybody else.
No, I would be... I mean, like, thing I'm most excited to continue doing on Kyoto is, like, the levels and, like, construction and stuff. So, like... Like, I got super nerdy about, like, the other day, about this bridge. Oh, you're going to be 30 seconds behind me. But, like...
Yeah. I will wait with anticipation.
Like, it's not that complicated, and it's not that great. And it's pretty whatever, but... I mean, I made it, so it's getting there. But I was like, oh, I really want all these, like, little thingies that they had in this reference photo that I have. Let me see if I can find it. in my private stream.
While you do that, we have a question. Uh-huh. It's a question for me and a question for you in the chat.
Oh, perfect.
So I was asked, what have you been trying to master recently? Oh, man.
Wow.
What have I been trying to master recently? I've been like, I've had a year of wearing like all the hats. So it's been sort of crazy.
You feel like a generalist in that sense? Or you
I've been mastering the art of juggling everything. But I think that design wise, like, it's been, since I've been working on Slow Down Bull for a year, I haven't done much combat design, and I think before I moved on to that, like, I was like, I want to get good at combat design, and so I had, like, I was really focusing on that a lot, and then I had this year of a non-combat game, and now, like, I just did my 7-day FPS, and it's just, like, straight-up combat game, and it sort of got me excited again. I was like, yeah, I really, really like combat design. I want to get super good at it.
You're gonna get like back into it.
Yeah. But otherwise, then I'm not necessarily trying to master, but in general, I'm trying to get better at systems design because it is probably my weakest skill. So I've been trying to do things to help me improve my number sense. And it's like super boring stuff. Like, so I play Nuclear Throne all the freaking time. And so I was like, well, if I'm playing this all the time, I should start trying to dissect it. So like, I do things like when I play, this is so nerdy. Oh my God, I can't believe I'm saying
this. Do it. Talk about it.
So I have these spreadsheets, right? And I just track data. And this is on recommendation of Mike Burkhead, because I was like, Mike Burkhead, I want to get better at systems design. What do you recommend? He's like, you just need to start collecting data. Just anything you play, just like collect as much data as you possibly can. And then when you start looking at it, you might have a question, you start looking at it and find your answers. So like, I'll write down what weapons drop, what spawns in all the chests, how many like dudes are there, like, do alligators spawn in the sewers? And you just write it all down. This is a big, stupid spreadsheet.
So you're making a game FAQ.
No, it's like, but then I gotta start asking questions. I'm like, okay, could I, like, reverse engineer their spawn percentages? Like, can I develop a number sense for that? But it's difficult for an early access game because, of course, all the numbers change every week. So right now, I'm not even in the point of answering questions. I'm just trying to get good at writing down the data. Like, that's it. I'm just going to get good at writing shit down.
Wow.
And then when I'm like, all right, I'm good at tracking now. Now I'm going to, like, do this for a game and start looking at it. And it's the nerdiest thing, and it's super boring and hard, but it's like, I want to get better at it, and that's just what I got to do to get better at it.
When you use the word number sense, like, when I think of number sense, I think like JW from Blender has like famously good number sense where it's just like you're writing a system and you're like, oh man, what should the rate of fire be on this weapon? You're like 1.3.
Yeah.
In your game, you know what that means. Like I've gotten that with Hyperlight, and it feels really good to have.
Yeah, that was actually for me. It's like so. Mike Burkhead occasionally gives me spontaneous systems design homework. And he's like, all right, look at these numbers and tell me here's this progression system. Tell me what's wrong with it. And he can just look at a column of numbers and just see, versus I have to like make a graph, right? I have to like take the numbers and I have to plot them on a graph and like visually look at the graph and be like, oh, this is too, like, the spread is too big. But he can just look at the numbers and just tell. And I want to get that good. I want to be able to just look at a column of numbers and just tell what the curve is.
Oh, man.
So the question for you was similar. It was, what do you consider your strengths or things that you are trying to master?
Oh, for me?
Yeah.
On the Lisa and Teddy show?
On the Lisa and Teddy show. or the Teddy and Lisa show, I guess.
It's funny. Like, I've gone back and forth on what I want to focus on. So In grad school, when I was at USC, I was doing my master's in interactive media, and which is when I met you, I think. And I was mostly doing adaptive narrative study, like what are the different types of systems that have taken on the challenge of a scripted narrative that also adapts to player choice and things like that. And so my thesis was about that, and the game I worked on right after when I went indie, called The Moonlighters, which I never finished because of Hyperlight, but that was very narrative focused. So my thing was, and the reason I was in film school before I went to do games, so like I was a student of TV, so like episodic narrative and adaptive narrative was like my thing. It's not a really low-level skill to have, and it's like a very tertiary skill for like a young indie designer or indie developer. So that was my thing. And then when I started working on Hyperlight, and Beau and I started like programming together, like we were both learning a lot from each other. So then I got like really obsessed with like game feel and like hardcore systems design, to the point where largely I consider myself a systems designer now. So that became like my specialty. And now I don't know. Because Kyoto is basically like, you know, it was a lot of field design and it's some interesting systems challenges, and like all I'm going to be doing is making more and more weapons, and each one of those has its own feel and its own system to it because they're all pretty unique, or they're meant to be. Ultimately, I think my strengths, if I'm actually answering this question concisely, if I were to pause, stop rambling, and say something concise, I would say that my strengths are in like high level conceptual systems design in so much as they affect experience, which is to say like I can't look at a bunch of numbers and extract a curve from it and stuff like that, or I can't like instantly balance an upgrade system, but I have a pretty good handle on like the large scale implications of a system as it will affect the player experience. So when we talk about upgrade systems, when we talk about what NPCs do or don't do, what we let you do in a town, like inputs and stuff, like I have a pretty good handle on that sort of thing, which is a role that I play like very actively in Hyperlight. So like any decision that feels very systemsy, like how's our saving and loading gonna work, like I put a lot of attention into like what that means in the game. That's a thing.
Yeah.
A cool example is Ryan Green, who's working on That Dragon Cancer. Oh, wait!
Yeah.
This reminds me. Commercial break, everybody. Let me take
commercial
a
break.
Let me pause to tell you about what all this is. We're talking... I'm talking... We being me,
hi.
Are, meaning is, talking to Lisa Brown, who is a game designer at Insomniac, and who worked on Sunset Overdrive, which was just released, and you guys should go play on the X-Bone, which is an exclusive, yes. And slow down. What's the type of thing that slows down? I'm forgetting right now because I'm
Teddy.
Sorry, I'm also trying to like. I have to do things on the computer, otherwise our stream is just like static images. So
maybe that's what I was like. So you all learned a lot about dev streaming over the summer.
Oh, cool.
We dev streamed for the whole all summer, and I think one of the most helpful things was having other people on audio to talk, so that when you had to do something where you had to think, and you're like, oh my god, I have to stop and think, I gotta be quiet, and now the stream's gonna be bored, and the other person can just keep on talking.
That's pretty smart. I think I'm gonna be okay with some streams being boring, like, I'm just gonna be coding, and if you guys wanna watch it, that's what Brendan does for a podcast.
I mean, every dev stream has to find its own style, but... That's something that I really enjoyed.
I've been mostly just... Oh, I've turned that off. I've been mostly just playing my own game for a while we talk to work on my own feel for it.
Matt asked me earlier, do I cross-reference the data against how an arena makes you feel? Oh, I guess who I'm talking about when I'm, like, just working on data collection. I mean, yeah, it's relevant, right? But it's very specific to the game. Like, you can like, look at... Like, one thing is, like, okay, I want to know how fast a assault rifle should reload or whatever.
Mm.
And you could go, like, 10 different games with assault rifles and look at all of their reload numbers. and it would just be meaningless because the reason those games have the numbers they do is very specific to the game, right? You can't, yeah. There's not like a database where you're like, all right, I need a reload time for assault rifle. Let me just go look up what the best reload time is, you know?
Right. Transact context is important. And like,
it's super important.
Wait, Lisa, you're being too interesting. This is commercial break.
Oh, wait, yeah. Oh, I forgot about the commercial break. I'm sorry.
I was trying to plug Slow Down Bull and failing. And Lisa, who is at Wordle on Twitter and probably
That's
other
right.
things. WERTLE.
That's right.
And I guess I should plug that you guys are watching me play the early version of Kyoto Wild, which is a multiplayer game I'm working on. KyotoWild.com. There's links at the bottom. If you want to join the mailing list that I use very respectfully, so I only tell you important things, please sign up. So occasionally I can tell you when there's something that you need to know, like maybe whenever I need money and you can buy it and such. I also work on a game called Hyper Light Drifter. Someone asked on the stream, what is Heart Machine? So I guess I should say Heart Machine is the studio, the indie studio I'm part of, that is making a game called Hyper Light Drifter, which comes out sometime next year. That is the end of our commercial break.
Alright, commercial break over!
Hey, so back to being interesting.
Back to stuff that we were talking about.
By the way, I'm trying to do like 7 things at once, so if anyone has asked a question on the stream that has not been answered by us and it has like floated far, far away, feel free to just repost it. I don't think anyone will blame you.
Yeah. We won't judge you for it.
You asked that already.
Oh, man. What were we talking about just now? We were talking about, oh yeah, like context and...
Oh, context and for like, systems and stuff.
That made me think of, Nick asks for Teddy, what was the most important thing you learned about marketing your own games, coming from someone who doesn't know anything about marketing their own games?
So I guess marketing your own games is also like marketing your studio and marketing yourself when it comes to indie stuff. I've learned that something that I didn't think was true is actually true, which is that targeting specific press when you're trying to promote your game is really valuable. I used to read that and I was like, no, what if I put all this time into 3 emails and then none of them write about my game? I should just send a blanket email to 120 people. So I still kind of do that from time to time, but like for actual important things, it's much better to be able to target someone and be like, hey, I have this thing that I'm working on, and here's why I think that you specifically would like it. That's a very hard thing to do at an early stage when you don't actually know any press, because knowing that something would be interesting to someone is kind of a huge guess, right? Like, you're just like, oh, I guess Jason, like, I used to be like, oh, well, when I first talked to Jason Schreier, who writes for Kotaku, I was like, oh, he likes JRPGs, and I'm making a game that has, like, influences from that, so, like, I'll talk to him. But that's just because it was on his profile or something. Whereas now, like, I know people who've taken a vested interest in Hyperlight. You know, I know people who I go to first with information and with builds and stuff. I know people who've taken interest in Kyoto Wild before and in those types of games. Like, so I know who to talk to, and it saves them time and me time because I'm not wasting their time. I think the other thing that's just generally true, which maybe isn't about marketing games, but is that, like, a lot of this stuff, like, going to game shows, going to PAX, going to GDC, E3, talking about games, playing games, for journalists writing about games, is like kind of our life, or is a big part of life. And so I used to think it was kind of a weird, terrible, and like this is maybe relevant these days with what's been going on the internet. There's a misconception that like networking is networking, and that like talking about your games is all business. And at the end of the day, like it just can't be. Like there has to be a lot of personalness to it, because personalness is a word, and B, it's just, I don't know, it just helps to be friends with people in promoting your game, because, like, that sounds really dirty, it sounds like, oh, befriend people, and then they'll write about your game, but when you're talking about your own game, like, they're taking an interest in you as well, you know, that's part of the story for an indie game, just like, who are you, why are you making this game, why the hell are you, you know, doing 7 different jobs and not getting paid for it. Like, that's interesting to them as professionals, and it also makes everyone's life more fun, because it means they get to go to an E3 and talk to their friends and not just feel like they're working.
Yeah, that's a good point. Nix is asking because he's working on his project. Do you want me to plug your project, Nick? I'm plugging Uniball. Nick's got this game, Uniball, and it's an eSport. And he is trying to find other, like, indies who are doing eSports. And I think that right now, like, a lot of eSports focus on local multiplayer.
Mm-hmm.
Like your own game here. I don't know, are you making this an eSport, or are you making this, like, a funsy fun for fun?
I want to talk about a design term. You're going to... Can I interrupt the plug to talk about
it? Go for it. We'll interrupt the plug. I'll pick it up
again. My friend Zach. So Zach Gage is a designer out of New York, and he's like a super smart guy, and made a game called Spell Tower and a game called Ridiculous Fishing with the Flame Beer Guys. Anyway, I was talking to him about this game and about that sort of question. Like, is this an eSport? What is this? How do I deal with elements of randomness and things that, like, aren't compatible with eSports? Mm-hmm. And he has this great term, which is called... elasticity of I don't know if it's a skill or difficulty, but basically the idea is, the terminology is, does your game have a wide band of difficulty or a narrow band of difficulty or skill? And the concept is, a wide band means there's a it's the difference between the performance of a skilled player and a novice player. So a game that has a wide skill band is something like an eSport, right? Where if you get really good at it, you're very obviously good at it. You can win. Like, any time you sit down with a noob, you're going to win. Like, if you're playing a fighting game, like, you're just going to win. And a narrow band is something that's like, you know, a casual game, a game with randomness in it, something like Mario Kart, obviously, where, like, you can be really, really good at it, and for the most part, like, occasionally you'll lose to somebody who's just messing around.
Yeah.
So, to answer your question, I have been exploring how much I care about having that narrow band that's required for an eSport.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm trying to find ways to support it. I have actually a lot to say on this subject because I've talked to a lot of people about this question. Where is Nick falling? Is he's going towards eSport?
Yeah, well, see, Nick's game, Nick is kind of his game has an unusual story in that. So he made Uniball like 15 years ago, like when he was in high school, and people still play it. Like, it still has an active community of players that are highly skilled at the game. And only recently, like a couple of years ago, Nick's like, I'm going to reboot it for the modern age. And so it's kind of a challenge because he has like this community of highly skilled players. Like, the mechanics, like, you can't really change the mechanics, right? They're like you can't change them. They're locked in.
Mm.
And so, like, figuring out how to make it accessible for new people and blah, blah, blah. But I think the story is really interesting because it's, like, here's a game that's, like, probably one of the first indie esports ever. I mean, it was, like, 1998 or whatever when this game existed and has had a... You know, it's a small community, but it's a consistent community of players. And by the way, Nick does dev streams on Uniball on Sunday nights. So if you guys are like Jones in for some dev tomorrow night, you should drop in on his stream.
Did you know, fun fact, I haven't actually learned how to do it, but that there's a way to like restream on Twitch now.
How do you do that?
I don't know, but there's a way to be like, oh, I like this stream and I'm not streaming right now, so if you go to my stream, it'll just run the other stream.
Yeah.
I don't actually know. Anyway, that's awesome.
Anyway.
Where would people go to watch that stream?
Well, UBDub, you could just, that's the channel, and Nick's talking right now.
Oh, yes. You can host someone else's stream.
Oh, Nick says you can host someone else's stream.
Yeah.
Oh, interesting. But he says that Uniball definitely has a wide band. A player who's played for an hour will beat a player who's a complete noob. Someone who's played for a day will beat a player who's played for an hour, etc.
Hmm.
And he actually toyed around with like a local version. And it's really funny when you get a bunch of noobs in there because it's like kindergarten soccer is what it's like. Everyone's just like swarming around the ball. And it's just like totally ridiculous and it's fun. But if you watch some of these people who've been playing for 15 years play, and it's like really impressive. You can like tell, you're like, these people are really good at this game. And I can tell like just from like, even if you don't know anything about the game, you just like sort of glance and watch a match. You can tell these people are super skilled. Yeah, the game came out the same year as StarCraft 1. There are people who have been playing it for over 10 years. So that's sort of an unusual story, right? Because when he launches this, like, how much of that story should be a part of this, of the new version?
Of the marketing.
And yeah, and it's like, it's tough because, you know, reboots can be really tough. Like, but at the same time, I think it's a pretty compelling story.
Yeah, I think
it still's got that community, you know?
I think that that's something, like, I think that there's something to be said for that. I think there's also something to be said for leaning too hard on that, because if you look at something like, I remember, maybe this is not the best example, but I remember during the hottest age of Kickstarter or whatever, like, maybe, I forget when it was, like, a year ago, when Brenda
Romero.
Oh, yeah,
right. Yeah, they were like, we're going to reboot this, and
they're going to make
just the...
Yeah, Brenda was like, I'm going to make an old school RPG because I worked on Wizardry, and, like, I know how to make those, and this is all about, like, this game or the genre that's existed for a long time. And they didn't get funded. I mean, they also asked for a ton of money. Like, they asked for, like, $1 million minimum. But, you know, it's like, that story is interesting in so much as the personal story, and then for a lot of people, you also need just kind of to not make it, like, to not ignore the other parts, because for the people who's going to be like, oh, that's interesting, and I don't care about that. What's the game about, you know? So as long as you don't get too stuck in it, I think that's a really valuable thing to be approaching press with.
But what I was going to mention earlier is I feel like in the indie scene, there's a big thing going on with, like, competitive local multiplayer games. And they have, like, the, what is it, where they, like, have tournaments all over. It's like a newish thing. What is it called? Oh, fuck, what is it called? You know what I'm talking about, right? It's like local multiplayer tournaments in different cities around.
Well, there's a new small thing that's happening this weekend called the Indie Circuit, which is like...
Yes, Indie Circuit. That's what I was trying to think of.
Yeah.
So there's Indie Circuit. But I'm, like, wondering, what is there something like that for online indie esports games? Because it's sort of a bit of a different beast. Mm. And I don't know if there is. And I think that, you know, maybe there's room for that right now, because, I mean, local multiplayer is certainly, like, kind of exploded, you know, as far as like, watchable competitive games.
Mm.
And so I'm like, well, is there something like that for online games? And where are the indie esports people, and how can we get together and be friends?
Mm. Well, I mean, you can talk to them or talk to people. I mean, if you don't know any of the people that I know, I should introduce you, because I know some of them. I mean, like, obviously I know Bo really well. I mean, Samurai Gun. I know Matt Thurston really well, or fairly well. You know, Towerfall. And Mark lives in LA, so you can talk to Mark about Nidhogg.
But is that, like, is there a substantial difference in the competitive local scene and the competitive online games, that is there, like, enough crossover, or is it different handling? Like, I don't know. It's tough.
I feel like competitive... Well, it depends what you mean by scene. Like, I don't know if there is a really competitive... Like, I don't think there's a competitive local multiplayer scene in the indie space. I think that competitive local multiplayer works in a lot of the scenes that are just indie games, or that are games in general. And so it's not a scene specifically of enthusiasts for local multiplayer games. It's a scene for enthusiasts of hanging out with other developers. And so they play games together in the same space. That's local multiplayer. Like, do you know what I mean? Like,
That makes sense.
Yeah, it's a secondary culture. So in that way, I would say no, it's not the same as whatever online scene you're talking about at all. But I also get the impression that most online scenes tend to, like, revolve around specific games, and then, like, they don't cross over one-to-one very often, but I could be wrong about that.
Yeah, it's kind of a weird space to figure out, because I feel like, you know, there's big esports, you know, like, there's your League and your StarCraft and your Street Fighter and whatnot, but, and then there's, like, you know, a lot of the small multiplayer, local multiplayer stuff, but there's that, like, middle part of, like, people who are making highly competitive indie games.
Yeah, well, I mean, someone to talk to is Simon Ferrari, who curated the esports area for IndieCade this year.
Yeah.
And now works with Indie Fund and He used to work with the Invocist a lot in Georgia, and now he lives in New York, so he's part of that scene now. But he's super invested in, like, very competitive new games.
Someone asked, Teddy, did you go to school for programming?
Oh, technically. I went to a school called Columbia in New York, and I studied computer science and music, but really I studied music, and I kind of studied computer science. I learned what it is to be a programmer, and then I forgot how to program. So none of my, like, tangible programming skill came from undergrad. I retaught myself to program mostly from scratch when I got to grad school, and realized that if I was going to be making my own games, I needed to have one of the core, what you might call, maker skills.
Yeah.
I love the core maker skills, which is, like, can you make, can you produce content where, like, in a bigger studio, like, I have, you know, there are people who, you can have someone who needs someone who's a specialist designer. Where, like, you're not programming or creating art. Like, you're probably modeling gray box levels and stuff if you're doing level design and stuff like that, but it's not defined by its maker skill. So when I was in grad school, I learned that, oh shit, I need to be able to do art or code if I'm gonna, like, make prototypes on two-person teams. Because also, like, you just don't have any say in a place like grad school where everyone's really interested in the concept. If you can't just make the thing you want to try, you need to get someone to do it for you who has their own ideas, so... anyway, that is to say, technically I went to school for programming, but all of my actual programming skill came from self-teaching and not from books and from asking my friends questions.
Matt asks about the whole wideband esports question. Do you think the hope of being the best is the primary driver of the popularity of like, esports? The hope of being the best. I think that the popularity of esports is more driven by the spectators and the enabling of spectatorship.
I was just talking to a friend who's another part of the community, and my friend Pat Miller, who used to be the editor-in-chief of Game Developer Magazine, and now he works for Riot, and he's very, very steeped in competitive esports culture because he works for Riot, and also because he's been a part of, like, Evo and that sort of thing for, like, 10 years. Yeah. And he was talking to me about, like, certain moments that, like, saved the esports community from dying in the United States. Like, he knows, like, the history of this thing. Mm-hmm. And from those conversations, my impression is that what that community is founded on is love, is, like, love of the game in general. So not love of being a player necessarily, and not love of, like, being a competitive player, but just you love the game so much that you want, like, you get excited about the depths of it and being good at it and people being good at it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I would say that I think that with StarCraft II, there was sort of an explosion because it happened right at the time when, like, Twitch was coming up and running, and so, like, watching, like, the technology of streaming video enabled you to be a spectator much more easily, and so I feel like that helped, like, get other people excited. Because, like you said, it's like when you're really excited about the game, you get excited to watch people play that game well, because, you know, I'm never going to get out of Bronze League, but I love watching people who can play it well because I can like identify with it. So it's like, not, I want to be the best, but like seeing other people who are just really good at it is, like, super exciting.
Yeah.
And why it's, I want to, like, watch.
It lets you participate in the deeper elements of a game without being able to perform them.
Yeah.
So, for example, if you relate it to physical sports, or real sports, whatever you want to call, like, not esports, p-sports, meat sports, meat sports. If you want to compare it to meat sports, like, people who watch football, right? Like, a lot of those people, like, don't have the athleticism to do some of the things they do, but they get to enjoy, like, the nuance of, like, what it is to be a wide receiver and catch a ball and, like, what you need to focus on. Like, they can talk about that and strategize about that and participate in high-level play without being able to execute it.
Yeah.
Those are two, like, understanding high-level play and executing in both esports and in meat sports, which is a term I'm totally going to keep pushing. That is, like, you know, they're two totally different things.
Nick mentions that he thinks the stories behind individual players can be really compelling, which I agree with that a lot. And I think that whole thing is what makes good casters for esports. Like, mm-hmm. you watch League or StarCraft casters, they sort of like create narratives for the players while they're playing, and that it's not just purely about the game, but it's also a lot about these individual players and the player story. And it's like, you know, who has everything on the line, and like, where did this person come from, and why is that relevant to this particular match at this moment? And then you get people that you're really excited about, and you just sort of like follow them, and their stories are, as a player, like outside the game, it's really really interesting. Here in Beat Sports, someone asked you a long question. Let me scroll up. DJ Boy asks, I am a 16-year-old who plays a game called Roblox where you learn a Lua type of coding. I'm well developed with their coding and I want to be a game programmer, but my friends keep telling me I should go to school for software programming instead of game programming because it's hard to find a job for game programming. Hey, Nick, you're a doctor professional programmer. You want to chime in on that from a different perspective? He's like not even paying attention to me. Nick.
Shit. So, wow, it's a career question.
Yeah,
it's asking you to give advice about game programming.
Yeah, I'm asking you to give advice. There's a guy in the chat who's 16 years old and he wants to be a game programmer, but his friends tell him that he should go to school for software programming instead of game programming because it's hard to find a job for game programming. What do? That's. Like,
well, my personal view is that...
Here, come over here talking to the mic.
Okay. My personal view is that game programmers
can do pretty much any type of programming because as a game programmer, you have to understand all the things that are applicable in, like, app development and in other things in terms of how to make code that's, you know, reusable, how to make code that's flexible, all that kind of stuff. So... I think that if you wanted to go to game school and study that stuff and then become, like, decide you don't want to do it and go be a traditional type of developer, that's fine. I think a lot of people do that, actually.
You think that's easier than, like, a traditional, like, software?
Well, my personal experience was I went to computer engineering school and trained as a traditional sort of computer engineer. And then went into games. But I think that was more difficult for me because the act of creating games is a lot more of a social experience than you might initially expect it would be. You really need to, like, you know, develop your, like, game design skills, your game communication skills, and be able to talk about games in an interesting way. And since I didn't have anyone around me that was as interested in games as I was, it took a while for me to learn those skills after I had already got a job.
All right. And that is what Nick thinks about that. Nick is a gameplay programmer in Insomniac, for context. He's been there for almost 8 years.
So he knows what he's talking about.
I
think the other thing that can factor into it is motivation. I mean, Nick was kind of touching on motivation. Like, the reason that I learned programming in college and then forgot it is that I was trained in, like, stuff that I don't really use anymore, like algorithm analysis and data structures, which is, like really core programming stuff, like how to make things super efficient and, like, what it means to be efficient. And I kind of know that and understand that now, but ultimately the things that I learned how to execute in college weren't enough to motivate me to make that a full-time job and to, like, have a love for it and to keep it up. And so I lost it as a skill and I had to relearn it, just like any language. Like, I lost programming languages. So had I dug deeper personally or had found an outlet for digging deeper into making games, whether that be going to, like, a game-focused program or just finding a community of people to work on games with, like, that would have made me want to program more. Like, I program games all day. I would not want to program for any other job. Like, if I couldn't program games, I wouldn't program. I would do something else, personally.
Yeah, and that isn't to say that you have to go to a game school, right? And mm-hmm. like Claire Williams mentioned, there is a lot of shady predatory game schools out there, and you have to be really careful when you're looking at schools. But if you even went to a traditional school for game programming, but found a really core game development community to be a part of during that, that also sort of, you know, that's another approach to it, I suppose. Someone asked, how did 7-day FPS go? And I say, it went really good because did you do 7-day FPS, Teddy? Probably not. You're like too busy working on real games and stuff, aren't you?
Real game. 7-day FPS is real games.
It is true. I made a game called Vertical Corpse that was a gift. It was a gift for a designer friend of mine, because my friend Josue used to tell the story about he used to be in QA like ages ago. He would always tell the story about this bug on, like, I don't know, it was the Medal of Honor or some game like that. But it was a bug in multiplayer where the ragdoll didn't work. Mm. And so when you died, the character just stood there. And the QA team, like, loved this bug because it was really fun. They would play deathmatch, and a bunch of corpses build up, and then they started, like, hiding among the corpses. And, like, it turned really sneaky and fun, and the QA team, like, really liked it. Mm. So I was like, Josue, that sounds amazing. You should just make that game as, like, its own game. And he's like, so I was like, I'm going to make this game for 70 FPS as a gift to Josue. Huh. And it went really well. And I showed it to him like 2 days in, and he was like, got really excited about it. And he's like, I could do like a map for you if you want. And I was like, that'd be amazing, because he's a really good multiplayer level designer. So he ended up working on the game too. So it's a little weird because it was a gift for him, but he helped make it. But it went really well, and I sort of set out to do everything I wanted to do. It's a really, really simple mod, and I was like, I'm not going to overscope this because I know this is going to be challenging. I'm working with new tools, with Unreal, and it's an online multiplayer game, so that's going to cause a bunch of problems. And both those things happened, but I like figured out the tools, and I got everything in that I wanted, and I got the multiplayer working. And people seem to like it. We played a couple games today and yesterday, and people had a good time. And someone made a Let's Play of it, like playing with their friend, and they were like, they really enjoyed it. And the whole thing of like sneaking and hiding among all the corpses is just like, it's sort of like plays on that hide and seek, like, I don't know. We probably have synapses in our brains specifically devoted to hide and seek. It sort of scratches that itch. But they were laughing, having a good time. So that makes me really happy that people enjoyed it. And people are like, you should keep working on it. Keep working on it. And I'm like, well, maybe. Okay, sure. I can keep working on it.
I like...
You
know, hide and seek. I think I studied hide and seek at one point when I was doing a talk on comedy in games.
Mm-hmm.
I was doing a talk on comedy and games as it relates to systems design, and exploring the idea of, like, what does it mean? Can you systematize or, like, get familiar with what it means to make a funny game outside of the writing and authoring of content? Like, what are funny mechanics? And with studying low-level brain stuff, like, how comedy is a thing because of one of the theories, like, pattern recognition, that, like, it fucks with our... ability to observe patterns in like a way that we like. So like the classic like 1-2-3 joke where it's like you establish a pattern, you continue the pattern, then you break it to have like an unexpected twist, is like, that's why it's funny. It's because like our brain like trips for a second. We're like, what?
Yeah.
But since it's done in a safe space and it's not like we're going to get killed by a tiger, like our brain.
Right. And it's like delightful.
Yes.
Yes, you do have to run a bat file and manually share your IP address to play the game, because it's like fucking 2002 getting that to work. But I think this is really silly, but I think the thing I'm the proudest of in that 7-day FPS game is making that crappy lobby work.
All right.
Because it's like, you know, I have like, all right, you enter IP address and hit join. And then, like, once everyone gets in there, then the host can start the game, and it moves everyone to the game, which seems like a really simple thing. And a lot of all the hard work is built in, right? Because I was working off of the shooter template in Unreal, which has all of the netcode that's like already in there.
Mm.
But it's just like, oh my gosh, getting it to work was so hard, and I'm super proud of it. It's like really old school. But you know, okay, so I had an observation about this, and I was telling Nick about this. Is that the act of like, all right, I'm gonna get in this IRC chat and sort of get people together into this game, and like, who wants to play? And okay, I've got a group of people, now everybody get in the game, here's my address, and is everyone in? Everyone in? Everyone ready? Okay, we're starting the game. Like, that whole process, it's like super old school. And there's a lot of problems with that, and so a lot of that's been fixed with how you get into multiplayer games and modern sits. But there's also something about that process that's kind of intimate, like this process of gathering everybody together to play and like wrangling all of the logistics, getting everyone in there, and then actually playing. That's sort of like, it sort of makes a connection with everyone before the game starts, and it feels very friendly. And I think that that the way like modern matchmaking works and stuff, like that whole system was to fix a lot of problems with, like, you know, when you didn't know anybody playing the game, so it was really hard to like find games or whatever. But in that process, like there's like an intimacy there that's sort of been lost.
Oh, totally.
And I didn't have that insight until I was like getting people together to play this game, where it's like, you know, when you have like, when you're like going through that process of gathering people together, there's something special about that's kind of nice.
Even just engaging with them, you know, like being, all right, guys, are you ready? Like going into a online multiplayer game that does matchmaking for you, like you don't have to engage with the human beings. Like, when you're in a chat room before you're embodying avatars, all you can do is talk as a person or as a username, and like, you don't have to say anything. You don't have to say hi, guys. Like, and that always unsettles me when I start a game and we're in the chat room and there's like one or two characters or players that like aren't talking.
Yeah.
It's like, that guy is like, I'm creeped out right now. It's like I'm standing in a room and they're just staring at me. I'm like, ugh.
You know? Anyway, it just got me thinking about that aspect of it a lot, which I haven't really. You haven't really considered. Like, sometimes you get so caught up in making your game that you forget that the processes attached to your game can still serve the narrative of your game, I guess. Like, the process of how do people get into this game? Like, how do they find each other? How, you know, that sort of stuff, which is just like, all this, like, logistics stuff can still, like, serve the nature of your game.
That makes sense to me.
That's a little meta, I suppose.
Meta's good. What's going on the chat? Anybody got any questions or anything? We've got like people 50 people. We've had like 50 people in here all night.
I know. That's
pretty good, I guess.
We're having conversations about players making a lot of money playing games, and it's like a debate on that, I suppose.
Matt asked me on Twitter, off-channel. Is he here still? Well, anyway, I'm just going to say on the chat, and hopefully Matt's still here, that I did give a talk on systemized comedy in games, but it was never recorded. That's a total lie! It was recorded, and it's on my website. It's on my website. I recently added like a little page for talks, which has almost nothing on it, except for that, and trapped in the comments, but you can watch that talk. It's a micro-talk. It's only 5 minutes, so it's like very light. And very conceptual, but it just explores, you know, it's what a micro talk is. It's kind of.
I want to do another micro talk. I had a lot of fun doing doing the demo night glitch, and I want to do another one.
Okay,
I've got like, make it happen so I can give another 5-minute talk.
Oh god. Okay.
We'll add it to our list. Of
we have another. Yeah, we have another talk thing to set up.
Yeah, we're gonna set up the Vine conference as well. Yeah.
It's a secret still. You can't talk about it.
Sorry, it's secret, guys. But I didn't say nothing.
There's a question in the chat. I have a question. Not me, the person talking. I'm reading the question. I don't have a question. Wait, I have a question. I don't have a question.
Read the question!
Why did you pick a shirt with pink stripes? Oh, that's not a question. Oh, here we go. How do you split your time between HLD and Kyoto Wild? Hyperlight has a wonderful culture of healthy work. Healthy work schedules that is predominantly led by the fact that a lot of the members of the team, probably myself not included, have a very good focus on health, and particularly Alex, who as is very publicly known, like has like does not have the best health, like in terms of medical sense. So he's just very wary of overworking. And so like he never wants anyone to kill themselves or to work too hard. So we work Monday to Friday, like 10:30 to 7:30. And then that's like our common hours are like 11 to 6 or 7. And that's when we're all working together. And nobody really works weekends at all. Sometimes we talk about the game over the weekends, but we don't sit down and do our stuff. Alex does sometimes because Alex, you know, he's been doing it for a long time. But that's how I split my time, is that that's my like day job, I guess. My day job is making games, and then my night job, I'm moonlighting as also a game maker.
Oh my god, I love it how you're like talking up how Heart Machine is all about the work-life balance and like the reasonable working hours, and then you just like fill up the rest of it with more game dev.
that's a darker live stream to talk about. But I balance my practically speaking, what I do is I work on Hyperlight, and then like 60% of the time I worry about Kyoto Wild and I don't make progress on it. That's changing now, I think, hopefully. Having a team is going to help me with that. But normally, like when I actually do productive work on Kyoto, it's like one weekend day during the daytime. Tonight's an exception, I guess. And maybe like one weeknight I try to commit to working on the game. So it ends up being like 10 hours a week or so, if you were to clock hours.
Yeah, yeah.
How much time have you put into, did you put into your 7-day FPS, Lisa?
Actually, it was pretty mild. So I'm a very mild jammer. I do not overdo it because I have health issues as well, and I can't pull the all-nighters. And I'm like, whoa, was it really this late? But let's see. So I couldn't work on it at all on Friday nights because we were at BlizzCon. We went to WCS finals.
Oh, I saw your picture.
Yeah, and so I worked on it. I worked on it quite a bit Saturday morning to afternoon. So that was like maybe from like, I don't know, 9 to 2, I suppose. Then we had to go to a wedding in Santa Barbara. Ooh. And then I worked on it a little bit Sunday morning, maybe a couple hours. And then I had a friend who was in town who I hadn't seen in 10 years. So I had to hang out with him.
Mm-hmm.
And I worked on it a few more hours that night. And then, like, during the week, I could only maybe work on it maybe just, like, a couple hours a night just because I had other stuff going on. So, like, it was not, like, it was like, a steady burn. Like, I was tired, but it wasn't, like, it wasn't, like, bad. It was, like, okay, I'm just working really hard on this, but I'm only working on it, like, a couple hours a night for the whole week. So it, because you know I work full time, and then I come home and I gotta walk the cat, you know, I gotta cook dinner, whatever, and then I only have a few hours before I get too sleepy and go to bed. So it was it was pretty mild, I guess, compared to people who are just like just churning on it, and that sort of tends to be my approach to jams. Like I feel like I've gotten very good at appropriate scoping.
Oh man, that's such a good skill. Have you played Five Nights at Freddy's?
I haven't, but...
It's like, play it and like, as a developer, you'll just be like, holy shit, this is good scoping. Like, you look at the game and you're like, oh, you could build that so fast and then release it, and like you did. And like, I think there's already a sequel out, and that's also done really well.
Yeah.
It's like, whoa, dude, this guy knows, or these guys or gals or whoever made it, like, they understand scope. It's crazy smart.
Yeah.
There's like zero animation in that game.
But like for 7-day FPS, it's like, okay, my game it's deathmatch, right? It's just deathmatch with like one thing that's changed. And so basically it was like finding the tools to figure out how to do that, which was great because I basically went into the code and turned off all the things that I was like, oh my gosh, this is like so bad that I'm turning this off. It's so bad that I'm not cleaning up the guns when you die. So there's going to end up being like 50 guns and I don't know how to disable the gameplay code on them. So it's like, it's just like going to be like hundreds of guns on the level and it's so bad, but whatever, it's a jam. So, you know, figuring that out, figuring out how to mod the gun, And then like we played and we came up with this idea of a timer that if you stand still for too long, it kills you. And that was actually challenging because I had to figure out the HUD stuff and then, you know, the lobby stuff. So there was a lot of like little things to figure out. But the core of the game was, this is just deathmatch. I'm just going to take the shooter example game in Unreal and just mod that because I don't have a lot of time for this jam. And it's fine. Yeah, Nick has been a little too hardcore on jams this time. So yes, I will agree with that.
Scope on jams is important. Yeah, because it also, jams are meant to be, I think, like an enriching and enthusing experience. You know, like sometimes if you're not working full time, like you're looking for something to work on. It's like a chance to try something and potentially like become your new full-time thing. So like to come out of a jam like burnt out and exhausted and kind of frustrated is a really unfortunate way to come out, you know. So scoping can help a lot with that because it helps you come out of it and feel like glad that you did it. Because I've finished jams with a game that doesn't work and been like, this is miserable.
Yeah, so the thing you mentioned about that is interesting, is like how you go into a jam. And you know, for me, since I work on games full time, like jams are just like, they're just like whatever, you know. I'm just like, I'm just gonna try something just for fun, whatever, you know, just to try something weird. But some people, like, they go into them like with a attitude of, you know, this could be like the next game they make. And I'm always super impressed with people like Ludum Dare who take their Ludum Dare game and then end up making it like a full commercial game. Like, that's really cool because that's like not how I approach jam. So it's like, seems super impressive to me.
This game was a jam, sort of. We were throwing a party at Glitch City early in the life of it, like in the third month. And, it was a fundraiser for Alex because this was he super was having some health difficulties and needed some money, and so we threw like a fundraiser, and a couple people made games, like original games. We were like, please come to the party, like we're making games for it. These are brand new games. So I made this for the first version of this back then. I like jams. Chat. Oh, somebody asked me about narrative thingies. Tell me, iPad, what was the... I mentioned adaptive narrative earlier. Can I share some knowledge about it? Sure. Something concise. That's a good example. How about, like, once, so a really, really common technique for adaptive narrative is multiple endings. Or, like, historically, that's something that's been used, particularly in long RPGs and things like that. So I guess this is like one super tiny tidbit of research, is that like those can be really valuable in so much as they still reflect choices that were made in the game that they're relevant to. So like if you have like Final Fantasy X is a really great example of a really bad multiple ending, because like whether you get the good ending or the bad ending is just based on like random things. Like, did you find, I don't even remember what it is, but it's like, did you find this item? Like, did you win this battle? Did you talk to this guy at the right time? And it's about like weird performance things. And like, you just kind of feel like you failed. Like, it's not your ending. And I think a successful multiple ending feels like your ending. You know, that's an important part of it. Also, you can like do things like what Mass Effect 3 did and disappoint people by like, being counterintuitive to what the rest of your systems are about, you know, which is to like, is to make the promise for the entire series that like, this is your character, this is your thing, and then have the ultimate ending decided by a couple arbitrary decisions right at the end. So yay for multiple endings, but if they're not motivated by real decisions that are relevant to them, you get stuff like, I was arguing to someone why I had the same experience as them, even though I got the bad ending in Final Fantasy X, because then I watched it on YouTube. Because it was like, literally, it doesn't matter. The things you did that I didn't do had nothing to do with the ending. So if I stop at the end and go watch a YouTube video, I've had the same experience as you. Yeah. Anyway. Maya Sasai, she says she loves you, Lisa.
Wait, who loves me what?
Maya.
Oh, where is the love? I don't see the love. Where is it?
She's on a text message.
Oh, okay. Alright, hi, I love you.
She's doing like the desert bus jam.
Oh yeah!
or desert bus marathon.
Yeah.
Apparently they've raised like 100k or something.
There you go.
Should we?
Adriel wanted me to make drawings for her game.
Uh-huh.
And I was like, okay. But then she's like, alright, I'm gonna go, like, she's like, all right, you need to draw some things. I'm going to go. And I'm like, wait, I need context. I need context for, like, her like, crazy lens game. So I was like, can I just use some of my animal drawings? Because I have, like, all these animal drawings for when I do, like, spontaneously draw animals on Twitter time. I just, like, use some of those because you're, like, trying to find pictures.
Is this gone right here. Is this her last one day a week or is this for a
it
game?
It is.
Oh,
it
my
is
God.
The last one.
I mean, this is like a real party for her.
Stressful. I'm gonna go visit Adriel. You know that?
You're going to those Netherlands?
I'm going to the Netherlands in December. And I'm going to hang out with Adriel.
Can I ask when? Because I'm maybe going to the Netherlands in December.
I'm going from December 2nd to the 11th.
Incompatible.
Incompatible? When are you going?
I have 7 days where I'm a free agent in Europe, and I'm going to be in Paris for some of it. I'm just considering skipping town to go to Utrecht for a while.
Oh.
I think they're in Utrecht, right?
When are you? When is that time?
Oh, that's December 27th to January 3rd. So.
Well, bad for us. Well, okay, why are we... this is silly.
Oh, talking about
the
Shane?
Why are we disappointed about this?
Oh.
No, because we can just, like, literally, like, drive across the city and see each other. So this is bad.
Oh, yeah.
Us, but because she'll get like, double friend.
Double friend.
Double
she'll get, like, two in a row. Night's got...
Yeah, people are getting sleepy. I'm starting to get... This is, like, way later than I normally stand up. But stand up? I can't even speak.
This is the time I'm the stand-in.
Yeah. Does anyone have questions for me, because I'm probably gonna fall asleep here soon, but I want to make sure.
We'll say this is the Lisa and Teddy show, so we'll say goodbye together, because there's some things I still need to do in the game, but they're super boring to watch, so the stream is discouraging
me. Last call for questions. It's here.
Last call for questions.
Yeah.
Get your questions answered here.
Yep. Questions.
Also, don't forget to follow Lisa on Twitter at W E R T L E. That's this. 12. Oh, whoa, I'm talking to you on Skype.
Oh, yeah. The craziest story I have from working at Insomniac. Man, crazy stories. Man, it was probably the time we almost got arrested on the Sunset bus at E3.
What? Oh, I heard about that.
Did you hear about this story?
Yeah, tell the story.
Oh my god. Okay, so story time. So at E3 this year, because they do this thing at the Microsoft press conference where all the people, like, pull up in car. They have, like, the green carpet. Everyone, like, pulls up in a fancy car and gets off at the green carpet and goes and talks to, like, I don't know, talks to, like, Major Nelson or something, and then goes into E3.
Yeah.
And it's like super swank or whatever. Yeah. And so for Sunset, we were like, all right, we got to do this, like, Sunset style. So they got that bus, right? Did you see the Sunset bus?
Oh, yeah, that bus was sick.
It's like this old modded school bus that's, like, literally falling apart. And they, like, painted it up all Sunset style. And it's, like, got, like, a dummy OD strapped to the front. And it's just, like, super silly. And so before E3, I was like, hey, we should dress up in Sunset cosplay at E3. That'd be really fun. People were like, oh, yeah, that'd be really fun. And then James, our community guy, was like, oh, you guys, how about this? How about we get people dressed up and come to Microsoft Presser, ride in on this bus, and we'll all, like, roll out in Sunset gear with Ted, and it'll be, like, really fun. And everyone's like, yeah, let's do that. And he's like, all right, you got to be down there at, like, 6:30 on Monday morning. We're like, oh, my God. But we're like, we'll do it for Sunset. So we're all, like, up, we're all in our get-ups, our Sunset Overdrive get-ups, and we get on this bus. And the bus, it's like literally parked behind the place, and it just goes around the block and pulls up and lets us back off. It's very silly. Mm-hmm. So we're all on the bus, and it's like a show, right? It's all like timed out. It's like show, like when people come up.
Yeah.
And so we like pull around, and we're like in the lane to like go up to the presser, and this like LAPD traffic cop, because he's like, you can't be in this lane, you gotta get out of the lane, you can't be in this lane. And we're like, oh no, it's part of the show. We had like this Microsoft PA with us. Yeah. He's like no, we're, you know, we have to hit our mark up here. And this like police officer, he just gets like really pissed. Whoa. He's like, you gotta get out of the fucking lane. And like, we're like, no, we're part of the thing, we need to go like drop off up there. And he's like, starts like yelling and like freaking out, and he's like, you don't get out of the fucking lane right now, I'm fucking arresting all of you. And like, holy shit. And so we're like, fuck it, let's get out of the lane. So the PA is like, has the poor bus driver, I feel so bad for him. So this guy's like yelling and like really angry, and so we're like, we put out, and we pull back around and the back of the building again, and we're like, oh my god, they're like, we're gonna, what the hell do we do? And so we like get like the security, like the E3 security people were like, hey, there's this police officer just like threatening to arrest the Sunset bus. Could you like get on the bus with us and like talk to him? They're like, oh, we're on it. And they're like, I'll call on the radios.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And like, they're like, it should be clear. And we're like, and the Microsoft PA is like, well, we would really feel more comfortable if one of you like got on the bus with us. And so it's like someone got on the bus, and we pulled back around, and sure enough, like that officer is there, like waving us onto the mark, and he looks pissed. He looks so mad. But at that moment where like he was yelling and like threatening to arrest us, Ted was on the bus, and he was like, "This is so Sunset Overdrive."
Oh yeah.
And it was just like, it was just like, oh my god, is this really happening?
Wow.
This is gonna be hilarious. And then, like, you know, he got out for his, like, presser interview, and he's like, yeah, we almost got arrested just now. It's awesome! Rock and roll!
Oh, that's what he was... Okay.
Yeah, oh my god, it was ridiculous. Anyway, so that's probably the craziest story I have from working at Insomniac.
I was so excited when I saw that trailer, because I hadn't, like, had it on my radar at all.
Yeah. I'm glad. I'm glad you enjoyed it. I'm glad people are having a good time with it. Makes me happy. Especially the traversal. My favorite, everyone is so happy that people don't want to use the fast travel. Like everyone, like Liz is like, I've never been so happy that people don't want to use a system I built. Because we're sort of like, oh, I have fast travel in, but no one wants to use it. Everyone just wants to roll around the city, and that makes everyone so happy.
I'm really glad to hear that.
So that was my story.
That's a good story. I think we should end on that story, everybody.
All right. Okay.
So, thank you all for joining us on the dev stream. This is an untitled dev stream that is me working on Kyoto Wild, joined by Lisa Brown, Wordle on Twitter.
Thanks for having me as special guest.
Oh, thanks for joining me. Maybe if this becomes like a better thing, then I'll do this more regularly and have guests, and you can come back.
Yeah, have special guests. It's more fun.
And
it's
I'll have more pro stuff going on.
Yeah.
So this is Lisa Brown, the game designer at Insomniac.
No, this is Lisa Brown, game designer.
That is Lisa, the other person. I am Teddy. I am making a game called Kyoto Wild and another game called Hyperlight Drifter, which is why there's a link to both at the bottom. Love you guys. This is the music song that you're listening to. Thanks to The Heavy for this song, for playing us out. I'm going to wait till the end of the song goes off the stream. Love you guys. Have a good night.
Bye-bye.
Thanks so much for supporting game developers and paying attention to us. It's fun talking to you. Bye, Lisa. Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Goodbye.